Microphones are on, I believe. Call the meeting of the City Council Finance Committee to order for Monday evening, October 19th, 2015. It is approximately about 7:04 p.m. Good evening, councilors, and good evening, guests, for being present this evening. There are a few people that are not able to attend this evening, but when we get to those particular items, I will tell you who they are on your agenda. Also, councilors, you'll notice item number seven, that's the appropriation of the $40,000 in regards to the holiday decoration and lights. And as you know, there was just a little miscommunication, misstep at the last meeting, finance meeting to City Council, but we did that at last week's council meeting. We acted on that and suspended the rule, so that has already been taken care of. With those few things being said, I know Councilor Stewart indicated to me that he would be coming late, and I have not heard from our other colleagues that are not present here this evening. Madam Clerk, we'll start with item number one.
Appointment, Officer David Santos of the Brockton Police Department as weigher of trucks in the City of Brockton. Invited David Santos.
Councilors?
Make a motion, favorable recommendation.
Mr. Chairman.
Motion's been made and seconded for favorable recommendation. Good evening, Officer Santos.
Good evening, sir.
Before I forward anything you'd like to say to the council at all, or?
No, sir.
Okay, very good, thank you. Councilor Rodriguez.
Mr. Chairman, I had actually brought forward some concerns that I had addressed with the chief. I have not heard back from the chief specifically as to the address of some of the concerns that I had. So I honestly would like to move this item to the next finance council meeting until such time that I actually hear back from the chief and see how these concerns that I've had was resolved.
Are these concerns based upon the position that he has, the weigher of trucks, or some types of those concerns, or other concerns, Councilor?
There were some concerns that I brought up to this body two meetings ago, and I'm still waiting for a resolution in those concerns. So I'd appreciate it. A motion to basically hold this back, a second to the motion to hold this back until next financial council meeting.
Okay, a motion has been made to send back to the City Council with a favorable recommendation. It has been seconded. Unless
on the motion, on the motion, if I could, through you to my colleague.
Councilor Sullivan.
Councilor at large, if that did happen, you're pretty confident that you wouldn't seek another postponement at that time?
No, I wouldn't, but I would like to, through the chair, I would like to hear from the chief and see how those issues were resolved.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, on the motion, I don't know if this is appropriate, but could we maybe have maybe a five-minute suspension of the meeting and have a meeting with the chief to find out what it is that Councilor Rodriguez has? Because I've not been made aware of any concerns that he might have about this particular appointment, and it has come before us a few times, kind of with a mysterious, you know, backstory. So is that appropriate?
I think at this particular time, I don't know if I'd want to be calling a recess so that we can huddle to have a conversation with the chief in pertaining to what could be the issues, because this isn't the right forum to do that.
Okay.
I think we should handle the position with the fact that a motion has been made and seconded to either act on it favorably or act on it unfavorably.
Mr. Chairman, if I could again.
Councilor Sullivan.
Through you, I agree with that wholeheartedly, that I think we need to make a decision, but in light of my brother counsel and the fact that the chief is here, perhaps we could put agenda item number one to the end of the agenda tonight, giving Councilor at Large Rodriguez and the chief some time to talk in private. Due to the fact that it is a personnel matter, we don't want to touch on that, but we might be able to perhaps reach some satisfaction since the chief is here and the council is here, and we could always push this off until the end of the night. My humble suggestion.
Okay.
So at this point, I think the way I would really want it cleared is probably to have the motion withdrawn to act on it, and then if you want to postpone it and take it to the next, you know, finance meeting, which is probably not going to be sometime until November, because I have not decided when that date has been set yet. So, but I would only say that if that's the case, that the next time it has to be voted up or down. It really, really does. It really does. If you have a problem, then you need to iron it out, and I've said that before. So,
Mr. Chairman,
on the motion.
Come to the end of the week.
Motion's still there.
As a member of this body, I brought a concern that I had to this body. It's not a personal issue. It's not a personal concern. It's a community concern. I addressed those concerns to the chief of police, who's the overseer of this particular position, and I'm waiting to hear back from the chief of police. I don't think that's asking too much from this body to basically, once I hear back from the chief of police, I do not have a one iota of an issue to basically even personally recommend that this position be moved. But I honestly need to hear, as one member out of this body, voted by the voters of this community, I need to hear back from the chief if I can move on this.
Then I'm going to entertain...
On the motion.
I'm going to entertain a motion that we recess for 5 minutes.
Okay. Motion we recess for 5 minutes.
That's your call. The motion on the floor, that's your call.
Yeah, you can call.
Motion, we're going to recess.
Thank you.
Call the meeting back to order. There is a motion on the floor. Motion was made and seconded to send back to the full city council with a favorable recommendation. Moving forward, all in favor?
Thank you, so nice, thank you.
All opposed? When in opposition, it goes back to, it goes back to the full council with a favorable recommendation. Item number two, Madam Clerk.
Order that the city council authorizes the acceptance of a donation of 2 retired dial-a-bat minibuses from the Brockton Area Transit Authority to the City of Brockton Police Department. The only stipulation is that the Brockton Police Department pays for the cost of leased tires, a total of $800 for both vehicles. The department will do this from its fiscal year 16 budget. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, John Crowley, Police Chief.
Good evening, Chief.
Good evening.
Anyone have any questions and concerns in regards to this particular item?
Mr. Chairman, I have a quick question.
Councilor Azak.
What are these minibuses going to be used for?
They're going to be used to transport members of our Honor Guard, members of our Special Reaction Team, and anyone else, the situation that may arise. If it was a youth camp or summer camp, we'll have a motor transportation beyond a police car to have people to ride in.
Very good. Thank you, Chief.
Make a motion for favorable recommendation.
On the motion, I just have one question.
Yeah, on the motion, Council Barnes.
Why are we taking a $500? Do people that drive this type of vehicle need a special license?
No.
Or is, okay. All right. Thank you.
Motion's been made and seconded to send back to the full city council. All in favor? Opposed? Goes back to the full city council. Item number three, Madam Clerk.
Order appropriation of $500 from the Spectra Energy Foundation to the City of Brockton Fire Department Spectra Energy Foundation Grant Fund. The intended use for these funds is towards the purchase of 1 laptop computer to be used in the field for hazardous materials responses, code enforcement, and fire prevention activities. This is a non-matching grant with no cost to the city. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Michael Williams, Fire Chief.
Councilors, Fire Chief Williams contacted me this afternoon, indicated he had a
motion
a commitment
for
in Boston.
Favorable
on the motion.
Second. Could I finish, please? So he was unable to attend this evening, so he will not be present for this item or the next item. Mr. Condon.
Councilors, there is a donation here for $500, and the fire department intends to use it to buy a laptop computer for field use for mainly coordinating its hazardous duty response team and code enforcement work.
Motion for favorable recommendation.
Second.
On the motion.
On the motion, Councilor Dubois.
Hi, how are you?
Good.
Can you tell me how this all came about?
No, I don't know the answer to that question.
Who was the applicant? Is Mayor, maybe the Mayor, Mayor Carpenter, since you're an invited guest, do you know how we came to get $500 from Spectra?
Fire Chief Williams informed me that they had received a $500 grant for a laptop. That's pretty much the extent.
Was it applied for, or did they just get a check in the mail?
I believe that they applied for it.
But you're not sure?
No.
Okay.
They did have to apply for it. They had to complete forms to
right.
get the grant.
Right.
Well,
right.
could I would like to request a copy of all the forms, and I'd like to know which department applied for it, and...
Well, the department that applied for it was the fire department, but I don't have the forms with me.
Can you supply them to us before our final vote next week?
Well, I'll have to get them from the fire chief, but yes.
Thank you so much.
Excuse me. On the motion, Mr. Chairman, I have that information that Councilor Dubois is looking for.
Well, I think that if you can... I think I would prefer to get it from the department just to make sure I get all the materials. I'd like everything. I'd like the cover letter. I'd like the budget. I'd like the application.
Well,
like
she's, excuse me, excuse me, but you should have the, did you get a packet?
It's in your packet.
In the packet. I'm sorry.
Okay,
it didn't come to me.
It's all here. We all have it. Every council has it.
I didn't get it. Just letting you know.
Last page is, got August 13th, date on it was my birthday, so.
Well, it's a big deal. You know, Spectra Energy is putting gas lines through our district, so it's not something that is just a free $500 check, just so everybody understands that. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Motion was made and seconded to send back to the full city council. All in favor? Opposed? Goes back to the full city council. Thank you. Item number four.
Order appropriation of $300 from Harbor One Bank to the City of Brockton Fire Department. The intended use is in the area of youth education and prevention. This is a donation with no cost to the city. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Michael Williams, Chief Fire Chief.
Mr. Condon.
Okay, this particular one is from Harbor One, and the purpose that the chief intends to use it is to provide educational materials to the fire officers who provide fire safety education support in the public school systems. This grant, well, I don't believe, was sought. I think it was just delivered to the fire department.
Mr. Chairman, make a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Back to council.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded to send back to the full city council. All in favor? Opposed? Goes back to the full city council. Thank you.
Thank you, Council.
Item number five, Madam Clerk.
Order appropriation of $571,152 from the McKinney-Vento Education of Homeless Children and Youth Assistance Act of fiscal year 2016 to the non-net school spending budget. This act provides funds to reimburse some of the costs of the mandated transportation associated with homeless students and provide additional buses to serve all eligible students. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Kathleen Smith, J.D., Superintendent of Schools.
Good evening. Good evening, Madam Superintendent. How are you?
I'm good.
Good to see you. Thank you. Any other words that you want to mention in regards to this or anything?
I just would like to say to the council that, again, this is one of those things in our budget that has become very, very costly. I know this is something that we're looking at all over the state. McKinney-Vento provides transportation, you know, for our homeless students, and I want to make sure that everybody has heard me say there is no better place to educate those students than in the Brockton Public Schools. Unfortunately, it is a stress on our budget. We have three hotels presently where students come from. We have three congregate houses, and we have over 80 scattered sites. Last year, we ended up with over 600 students that were considered our homeless population and just about $1 million. Some of it is reimbursed from cost-sharing communities, but it truly has had an impact on our non-net school spending and specifically the buses that we provide for our students.
Thank you, Madam Superintendent. Councilor Crew.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Superintendent. So is this money that we've gotten other years? I don't recall. Is this the first time the McKinney-Vento, or have we gotten this before?
This is not the first time.
It's the first time in this
format. It's the first time in this format.
Okay, that must be, because it didn't strike a bell to me. Now, this is $571,000. Approximately how much do we spend on busing the homeless families?
Last year, our busing cost was $994,000, which $93,000 was reimbursed from cost-sharing cities. Our total cost last year, City of Brockton, was $900,000.
So 10% was from cost-sharing communities last year?
$93,000, correct.
And we just ate the rest, or some of it came in this? How did it come in the past is my question, Jay.
It hasn't always been appropriated. This particular year, they appropriated it as a special fund. The check is already in. It requires appropriation from what's called available receipts, but it's a reimbursement for cost already incurred. So whether we receive this money or not, the responsibility would still exist to provide that service. It's a mandate. This simply helps us, and by appropriating it to non-net school spending, although it's a reimbursement amount, it means that we can purchase additional buses for the city's regular transportation costs, because we already had to provide for the homeless busing this year.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Council. Any other?
Motion to recommend favorably.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded to recommend favorably back to the full city council. All in favor? Opposed? Goes back to the full city council. Thank you, Madam Superintendent.
Thank you.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, the next item.
Order appropriation of $15,000. From the Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners State Plan for Library Services and Technology Act direct grant program entitled Serving Tweens and Teens. to Brockton Library Department Library Services Technology Act Direct Grant Program Fund. These funds will be dispersed by the MBL in the amount of $7,500 for the fiscal year 2016 and an additional $7,500 for fiscal year 2017. These funds are for the STEM program, which works to support and improve science and technology education. There is no match requirement. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Keith Coquette, Assistant Director.
Mr. Coquette indicated to me in an email that he was unable to attend because of a conflict, but Mr. Condon would have the answer, so appreciate
okay.
that. Thank you.
This is pretty self-explanatory in terms of the amount. It's $15,000, of which $7,500 is this fiscal year and the balance for the next fiscal year. This is money that was available through application, but it was through pursuant to a state appropriation of funds. Library system intends to use it for encouraging interest in the science and technology, engineering and math careers with Brockton students. Most of the work will be done at the Brockton Central Library, and the funding will be spent on procuring instructors who are in that field to try to encourage it, and also some like a microscope, telescope, the kinds of things that might get younger kids interested. That's the purpose of the grant.
Make no a motion match. For favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded for favorable recommendation. Back to the full city council. All in favor? Opposed? Goes back to the full city council. Thank you, Mr. Condon. Item number 7 we passed by. We don't need number 8.
Order appropriation of $6,395,631 from the fiscal year 2016 unappropriated estimated receipts of Water Enterprise Fund to the DPW Water Enterprise Desal Fixed Charge. $6,395,631. This appropriation will allow the Water Department to pay for the fiscal year 2016. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Larry Rowley, DPW Commissioner.
Councilors, I would ask tonight that the City Council Finance Committee move this item on to the full City Council favorably so we can act on the amount of money that we owe to Aquaria. I know there's an ongoing issue between the Council and Aquaria with respect to its contract performance, and this money was reduced from the budget in order to gain some interest in Aquaria to responding to Councilor's requests. Whether they have or haven't satisfied that objective to your satisfaction, I think is really not germane at this point to this particular invoice, because we're now several months into the fiscal year and we have received notice from Aquaria that we owe them the money under the contract. They have the right to charge us a penalty interest rate on the unpaid amounts. They haven't done that yet, but they've got the right to do it, so I'm looking to avoid having to pay interest cost on monies that we otherwise would already owe. So I'd ask you to move this favorably.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Sullivan.
Good evening, Mr. Condon.
Good evening.
Relative to the that they have not opted to charge the interest, has it been discussed either with the mayor or yourself, and have we gotten any concrete answer to that? Have they opined that they will not charge that?
The interest is due under the contract. The letter we received, which said you owe us money and under the contract we're accessing our rights, they haven't threatened to do it. I believe if the money is appropriated, they won't do it. But I don't have an ultimate assurances it's in their hands, but I don't think they'll charge us if this money is moved favorably, and we'll avoid it.
Thank you, Mr. Connor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Councilor?
Councilors? I still firmly believe it coincides with other item that's on the agenda, which we have not gotten to yet. So whether you want
to... Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to put number 8 after number 11 on the agenda tonight.
Second.
If we could.
Second.
Continue this agenda item to the end of the meeting.
Motion's been made and seconded. We take this item as the last item on our agenda this evening. All in favor of that? Opposed? We'll discuss that after we talk at our last item, which is... Aquaria business. Item number 9.
Mr. Councilor, Chairman.
Yes.
Let me just first.
My apologies. Let the clerk read it and then you. Yes. Go ahead, Madam Clerk.
Resolve that the City Council hereby requests that Brian Moriarty and Cindy Pendergast, or representative Neighbor Works, a Southern Mass program, comes before a committee of this council to report and lay out the plan for this organization. Invited Brian Moriarty and Neighbor Works representative and Cindy Pendergast, neighborhoods representative.
Councilor Azak.
I'd like to make a motion to table this.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded to table this item. All in favor? Opposed? This item has been tabled. Moving to number 10, Madam Clerk.
Resolve that the mayor and city solicitor be invited to appear before a committee of this council to report on what is being done to have the Commonwealth return to the city the Gainley Building property, and if nothing is being done, to discuss commencing efforts to have the Commonwealth return this property to the city. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Philip Nazarella, Solicitor.
Chairman.
Counsel Sullivan.
If I could, Councilors, you may recall a few months ago I mentioned I was going to file this resolve, and it was signed on by at least one colleague thus far, the Council President. I hope everybody will. But at the end of the day, just to flash back a little bit in time, as you remember, when Governor Patrick was in office, we had been assured that the city would be getting a college collaborative at the downtown Gainley Building, the building on Main Street known as the Gainley Building. We were told that it needed to be done ASAP, and in good faith, we did that. We conveyed it from the city to the state. So it is, as of today, it's a state building. As of many months ago, it's a state building. When the new current governor came into effect, the funding is no longer there to have the college collaborative at that location at this time, and I'll let the mayor address that. But again, I think at the end of the day, that building is not ours. It should come back to us, and if and when the funding comes in, and we're all hopeful the funding will come in, then we could always convey it back. But right now, that's an asset. That's the state. We can't control what they put in there. And in really all good conscience, they should convey that back to us. With that, Mr. Mayor, could you give us an update?
Sure. Good evening, Councilor. I think I understand the concern that you're expressing in the first half of your statement, but I guess I would respectfully submit that the concern is just a little premature. You're right that the project has not had additional funding this year. After Governor Patrick visited us roughly a year ago, just shy of a year ago, he came right after the election in November last year. The state did fund $300,000 for architecture and design, and that work has been going on. So although the project is on hold, there has still been work being done. There has been no decision yet by the Baker-Polito administration as to whether they will fund this project in the next fiscal budget or not. I certainly would share your disappointment this past June and July when the governor decided to take a step back and not fund any of the higher ed capital projects that had not broken ground yet. This was one of a number, including the Allied Health Sciences building for the Christo site that we're all certainly very concerned about also. However, you know, we were not totally surprised by this. We knew with the change in administration, we would probably have to resell this project again to the new administration. And there has been a really an ongoing effort, not necessarily in the spotlight, but there's been an ongoing effort by everyone working with the new administration to convince the administration to fund this project. This afternoon at a meeting we had downtown with Mike Brady hosting Senator Warren, this was one of many topics that came up, and Representative Brady talked about the collaborative effort between the three colleges and universities, our state legislative delegation, and my office, in working together in this ongoing review process. So what's happened most recently, roughly a month or so ago, the three college and universities, along with myself, met with Secretary of Education Pizer in Boston. We probably spent about an hour and a half with them, answered a lot of questions, and it was not just Secretary Pizer, he also had the Secretary of Higher Education there also. We are anticipating a meeting with Secretary of Economic Development Jay Ash coming up sometime in the month of November. So this is an ongoing process where we are working with the administration to, as best we can, convince the administration of the same things that we convinced the last administration, the need for this project, and also the economic development benefits to placing it in downtown Brockton. So I would just respectfully ask that we, you know, hold off on looking at this aspect. I think if we were to start moving immediately now for a building when a decision hasn't even been made yet, I think it could send the wrong signal during this period of review with the state. The, in terms of the assigning the building, signing over the building for a dollar to DCAM that you referred to in your question, that absolutely was a prerequisite of the Patrick administration and DCAM in order to get the approval for the governor to approve it. And that was a pretty standard provision that they needed to be assured that they controlled the site before they started expending funds, and they did. They have spent $300,000 to date on architecture and design. So the project is not dead. It's also not funded. It's somewhere in between. It's on hold, is the phrase that's been used with us. And we're certainly disappointed at its current status, but I think the members of the legislative delegation, the presidents of the three colleges and universities, and the city are all working together extremely well to put the best foot forward for this project and convince this new administration of the same thing that we convinced the last administration, and that this is a good investment for a lot of reasons, from workforce development to educational opportunities for our residents to the economic development impact. I don't think there's a great risk. The building is in deteriorating condition, I think that if the building commissioner were here tonight, and he's on vacation, but if he were here, I think he would tell you he would not be disappointed to let DCAM carry the liability for the building right now while we find out what the best future use of it is. But as of today, I think we're all still in agreement that the best future use for that site is for a downtown college collaborative, and we're working very hard with the new administration to make that happen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Mayor, I concur with you that the intent and the $300,000 was step one. But I don't think it sends a wrong message by this body talking about it, because I think the message was sent when the Baker administration didn't fund it. So at the end of the day, you know, we all hope that comes to fruition.
Right.
But I also know that when Governor Patrick was there, we were told, this body was told, it needed to be done ASAP.
Correct.
And then with the new administration, I understand that. But at the end of the day, DCAM in the state is the owner of that, owner of record. And if this never comes to fruition, then they can do whatever the heck they want with that building. They could razz it, they could put a charter school in there, they could do whatever the heck they want, because the state would control it. So I guess really the intent of this, and I've brought it up a couple months ago, and I am going to ask Attorney Nazarello to give me a quick viewpoint. I think at the end of the day, if you're working and the legislative delegation's working, that's awesome, and we would hope that, we'd expect that, anything we can do. But it was somewhat of a misleading statement that it was going to happen ASAP, and it didn't. So that's really why I think we needed to discuss this. And I don't really care if people in the administration are offended or this creates a little wrinkle, because the wrinkle's already been created by them.
Right. So if I could just respond, Counselor. I think that in terms of the building itself, if in a worst-case scenario we're notified at some point that they're not going to fund the project, and we're not anywhere close to that point yet, I'm not sure how bad we want it back. It is really in horrible condition. I think that if the school project doesn't go forward, the most likely scenario is that the building will have to come down. The demolition costs would be between $250,000 and right now that would fall on DCAM, not the city. If we were to take it back, it would. So just so I could be clear, in terms of the state's design for this new school building, it's not a rehab or renovation. The plan is to try to preserve and maintain the facade of the building, but that's all that's staying. Everything behind that facade is being torn down and eliminated. In essence, the plan calls for a beautiful brand new school building to be built behind an updated, restored version of the facade, because I think we all felt that if we could maintain that same historical look of that block, that was the ideal way to do it. But I mean, we literally, I recall one of the people that went in to see it fell through a floor. It's been looked at by a couple of large groups during that process with DCAM as they were evaluating how you would best convert this to a downtown college building. And the recommendations of all the experts were universal, that attempting to renovate what's left between the extensive water damage, the presence of asbestos, all kinds of other stuff that's going on, a floor plan that doesn't work, just is not economically feasible. So I guess just my concern, Council, would be if we, and I, you're right, we're not going to get the building back tomorrow anyhow, but if we were to push for that, that may not be the best deal for the city, because we could end up with a building that we end up having to take down at great expense to the city. There's been no indications of looking to put a charter school there. I think that you and I
just threw that out hypothetically. Yeah. I mean, they can do whatever they want.
Honestly, Council, that was one of the thoughts that crossed my mind at first, too. But they, I don't know that they could transfer it to the entity that's looking to develop a charter school. I don't think that's even possible. But in any event, it doesn't make sense to me when I think about it that if they're not willing to spend $15 or $20 million to, you know, to build a new building for it to be a college campus, are they going to then spend $15 or $20 million to then somehow try to transfer it to a private entity that's running a charter school? I think, and I share your concern with this administration with the likelihood of a charter school coming to Brockton, I think it's more likely that they would go after, you know, maybe one of the other vacant school buildings. And, you know, we control those buildings. So I'm not in any rush to create a home for a charter school for Brockton.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Barnes?
Yes, Mr. Mayor. I just have a few questions.
Sure.
I remember when this came forward, and it was like a rush, hurry up, we need to do this, and the time limit and all of these things.
Right.
And like Councilor Sullivan said, when the former governor came, you know, we were pretty much told that this was going to be happening forthwith because it had been in talks for decades.
Yeah.
So my question, if we can just kind of go back, and I'm not even sure if Councilor Dubois remembers in the real estate committee at the time, were there any stipulations put on, any stipulations put on the purchase of the building to the state that it would have to be this particular project?
I'm going to let Attorney Nesrallah answer legal questions. I believe the answer is that it stipulates it's to be used for the benefit of the three colleges, Massasoit, Bridgewater State, UMass Boston. But again, just to clarify, the rush at the time to transfer was because that was the DCAM requirement. This was going to become a DCAM project where DCAM would spend the roughly $20 million. In order for them to commit the $20 million commitment to do the school building, they had to have ownership of the parcel.
Mm-hmm.
And so the rush was not that they said they were going to build the school tomorrow. The rush was, in order to get the project approved by DCAM, they had to have ownership of it. And I think that, you know, we were all of the mindset that we were trying to get it done with the current administration because they had decided to support it, and to wait until after the election to see how the election went didn't make sense. So, but the actual plan at the time approved by the Patrick administration, it was about a four-year plan for this thing to get to fruition. It's a major mm-hmm. construction project. It's roughly a 2.5-year job between the demolition and the construction of the new building. And the Patrick administration was looking to spread the money out over a few years. They were not looking to write a check all out of one budget.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think that it was that the opening of the school was imminent.
Mm-hmm.
The rush in terms of the council's action on the real estate was that in order to get the school approved, in order to make the deal, the transfer of the property had to take place. DCAM would not commit to the money unless they had the the ownership of the property.
Right. And one other thing, too. You said that
it's been sitting there vacant for a long time.
Right. And like you said, in deteriorating condition.
In horrible condition.
Right. But I don't know. This might actually call for speculation on your part. But you said that in your meetings and things, you know, you've gone forward kind of indicating that in your position, the best project for this particular building would be the collaborative campus. Have there been any indication that they're looking to do anything else with that, or you know, what's the feeling from the other side?
Yeah, all of the discussions, Counselor, are strictly the three colleges and universities, UMass Boston, Bridgewater State University, and Massasoit, along with the administration and the legislative delegation. All of the meetings have been strictly about making the case, answering a lot of questions, presenting a lot of the same information we presented to the last administration to convince the governor to include this in the next round of funding. Have they given us any clear indication which way they're going to go with it? No, that's why we're working so hard on it right now. I think what the governor has asked is for both the Secretary of Education and the Secretary of Housing and Economic Development to conduct their own reviews of the project to make recommendations back. Now, Councilor Dubois has been very involved in the Allied Health Sciences along with this one, and Massasoit's going through kind of the same type of ringer, for lack of a better word, in trying to convince the administration for the funding of that project. I mean, I believe they should both be funded. They're both excellent projects that would benefit Brockton and the region. But they were caught up in a group of projects that the administration decided not to fund in this year's budget. The speculation, I think, is probably a little irresponsible right now. I wouldn't be shocked if we had to make some changes to satisfy any concerns the new administration might have. But I mean, I think we still have a real good shot at getting a downtown college campus. So again, the meetings and discussions are ongoing. I'm meeting with the three college presidents coming up in a couple weeks, and then a couple weeks after that, we're all meeting with Secretary Ash. So this is a very active, ongoing review with the administration, and they really haven't tipped their hand yet as to whether they're going to want to continue with the project or not. They have spent $300,000 on the design.
It just concerns me because if now the talks are taken from the educational kind of department of the state government and going to more of an economic development arm of the government, it makes me frightened that they may have a different idea of how they want to use that building.
Well, I think that I think the governor's looking for both perspectives. So obviously the Secretary of Education is focusing a lot of his questions around really more specifically with the university than with the universities in the city in terms of what the educational programming would look like, how does that supplement. I think the Secretary of Ed's, one of their concerns that's come through, is that they're not spending money, additional money, for programming that's already readily available at the three schools currently. That's not the case. What this project is not a traditional college building. You know, it's a very unique collaboration with a lot of the intended programming really designated to specifically benefit Brockton and its residents. A lot of workforce development, job skill training programs, programs that lead to degrees in areas that directly there would be jobs available in the Brockton area. So that's one aspect of it, but certainly there is an economic development aspect to this school. It's you're taking a building that's on the gateway at the Belmont Street entrance to the downtown that's long-term vacant and abandoned, and instead of hitting the end of Belmont Street, looking up and seeing a vacant, abandoned building, to have that converted to a beautiful, brand-new, thriving college building, I personally believe would have a tremendously positive impact. I think we got a bump in interest in the downtown when Governor Patrick announced that he would support the project. So I think that my take on this is that the administration is looking at it from both an economic development standpoint and an educational standpoint. And I think that those reviews are going on simultaneously on parallel planes. I'll tell you that every time I got a chance with Governor Patrick, I lobbied for the project, Every time I get an opportunity with Governor Baker or Lieutenant Governor Polito, I lobby for the project. I'm trying just as hard with this administration as I did with the last one, because I do believe that there would be a huge benefit to the city for a downtown college campus, because I look at some other Massachusetts cities that have brought education downtown, and those are the cities that seem to be having the most success in revitalizing their downtowns. Now, we're going full speed ahead. Many of you saw the downtown strategy action plan that was put out for public input a couple weeks ago. You know, we're certainly going forward with all of the other redevelopment plans for the downtown. We're not putting all our eggs in one basket, so to speak, but I think this is a really important piece of the puzzle, and that's why we're, I think, the legislators, the schools, and the city are working so hard for it.
Okay. And actually, since the solicitor, the city solicitor is back, can I ask my question? Can I go back and ask my earlier question?
Go ahead.
I asked the mayor about the agreement for the state for DECAMP to purchase the building for a dollar, and I wanted to just know, were there any stipulations in that the project that needed to go in that building needed to be the collaborative campus?
We attempted to put in those stipulations, however, they rebuffed that. They didn't accept it because they felt it would be an undue restraint on the alienation of property. They had a right to do what they want. However, in the deed, as grantees, they clearly stated that they were acting on behalf of the three particular college institutions. So there was enough to infer that the purpose of that acquisition was for in furtherance of the college institutions. But there wasn't specific language that that property had to be used for a specific purpose.
So it's it's feasible that they can really just do whatever they want with it now that they own it for a dollar?
Well, not necessarily. I think it's yes and no. The yes, it's possible. I wouldn't say feasible, but it's very argumentative that the sole purpose by the circumstances leading to that transaction was in the furtherance of developing college-like institutions, and they named the three colleges. That's stated in the deed. But when during the negotiations, they clearly stated they were not allowed to state that this was the specific and only use, because sometimes circumstances, unavoidable and unforeseeable circumstances, may arise where they could not bring it to fruition. But that was clearly the intent then, and I am still under the impression it is still the intent today.
Okay, so if they don't do that, if they don't follow through with the original intention or the, I guess, agreed upon original intention, do we have any recourse if they kind of go left and do something different?
Well, it depends on what they do. It's very speculative, and that's why it's difficult to answer that question. But as the mayor stated, the condition of the property is such that something is going to have to be done by them, and the ball is really in their court at this time.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Chairman.
Thank you. Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Dubois.
Thank you, Mr.
You're
Chairman.
Welcome.
So I have been involved in quite a bit of this, not only for the downtown building, but also for the Massasoit spot. And I am really concerned because it wasn't just the budget, it's the five-year capital plan that this Downtown College Collaborative or the Massasoit College building have been left out of. So that's a five, now that can be revised, sure, but it's a big deal that on the five-year capital plan for bonding, both of the colleges in Brockton were left off. So that's something that we should be cognizant of. And in the other hand, you should also be cognizant of the fact that my sense, and I mean, you know, this is just a few meetings, was that Massasoit is actually thinking about building the nursing program building on their campus as a potential. And so then Brockton would have lost our ability to, you know, predestine what's going to happen on that critical corner. And the state has that land locked up. And then the downtown building, when I was in a meeting, it seemed like they were leaning toward renting. There's some kind of weird thought at the governor's level that that having government services in public buildings that business could occupy somehow inhibits business, its potential to grow. It's this Ayn Rand weird thought process. So I am really concerned that we would leave this important parcel of land in the downtown of our city and the land on the east side, the entrance of the east side in our city over by the old Christos, up to, you know, Randians that think that we really need to push business interests over the interests of our general public and our public good. So I really commend Councillor Sullivan for putting this forward. We could get them back through home rule petition. We could file. I see that all the time at the State House now. I'm learning all these new things. You sit up there and the state rep shows up with a piece of DCR land or a piece of state land, and they want to give it to a church, or they want to take it back to the city of Boston. They do this like every day at the State House. So we could petition, home rule petition, to take both of the lands back. And then if we're going to redevelop into something else, we can decide. I think that people that live in Brockton and are elected by Brockton residents are much better able to decide what happens on Brockton land than folks down at the State House are. So I'm not saying that this is something that we should push forward this evening, but I think it's something we really need to consider, because I think if we're going to have those lands redeveloped and they're not going to be schools, we should be deciding what happens there. For all we know, I mean, do we really want, you know, a potential 18-story public housing block on the corner of where the old Christos used to be? Because we do need housing. Do we want that? I mean, and if we do want that, don't we want to control it and not have the state come in and say that's what's going to be there? Or a charter school? Because I've heard charter school as well. So I think this is a serious concern we have to think about, and I'm really nervous about. And I'm nervous that we did lose both of the colleges. And from an economic model, I think that the Allied Health Center building on the east side has a lot better of a chance of getting the funding. And I'm really nervous about it, because the Downtown College Collaborative is very important to our downtown. So I know I'm just like trying to fill in the blanks for you from what I know. Don't have too many questions, but I commend Councillor Sullivan for filing it. I think it's really forward thinking, and sometimes we have to punch back. And if they're telling us, you know, just sit tight, you can leave those parcels vacant until we decide if we're going to dangle the money to you or not, maybe we do need to take them back and say, well, you come back to us when you want. And I was the chair of the Real Estate Committee when I heard from Councilor DiNapoli that it was urgent that we have this, and we signed it over for a dollar. That I think we called the meeting for a Friday evening so we could sell the land for a dollar. Like, we're running around like chickens with their heads cut off to do this. We could do that again, right? So say we take it back and they want it back sometime, we can run around, have a Friday night meeting, sell the land for a dollar. But at some point, not tonight, we need to start looking at that. And remember that, you know, it's our city, and we shouldn't let some bureaucrats in the State House tell us how to develop our community, right? So thank you very much. Thank you for filing this, Mr. Sullivan.
Well, if I could just add, you know, Council, they are two very different types of parcels. Right. You know, the former Christos site is something that they, I think that I'm the last person to defend DCAM here. We're on the same team on this one. The site at Christos, I think the state's into that for about a $1.5 million. It was privately owned. It was not owned by the city. It's a prime piece of commercial developable real estate, and the demolition's already been done on the existing building. As opposed to the potential site here of the Ganley building, which to describe it as a distressed piece of property would be generous. It's been vacant for about 20
years. But it's our distressed piece of property.
Well, I get that. That comes with, and if the building commissioner decides to do a border survey and condemn it, it's our piece of property that could cost us $500,000 to take it down, where if it were condemned with DCAM owning it, DCAM would have to spend the $500,000 to take it down.
But we take that with CDBG money. So and it still comes from the state, and I know that we could use that money elsewhere. But and I understand your point. I take it. I think it's good. Yeah. But and at some point, we're going to have to do something about it.
Well, I get it. I just don't want to give the impression that this was like $200,000 building that we gave away for a dollar. This is a building that's falling apart. The roof has been leaking badly for years. The building commissioner would only allow very few people to even go inside it under very limited circumstances because of safety concerns. And you know,
well, I think that point's taken. All
okay.
I'm saying is that, for me, if it was a million-dollar building that we gave away for a dollar for a downtown college collaborative, I would think that we'd be getting a good deal.
Yeah.
So I'm not, I think giving away land that we know is going to be developed in a good fashion for a good community purpose, we should be doing more of that. So I don't think that you're getting any pushback from us on that. It's
yep.
just that we can't just hand over our land and then be told, you know, sit down, children, and we'll decide if you
right.
need education for your CNAs to become LPNs or we need any type of economic development at some point.
I think
that's
in,
all I have to say. For
in terms of us dealing with DCAM, I think we do also have to be cognizant that there are other DCAM leases and properties going on right now. So, I mean, DCAM has out an RFP for a district attorney's office, and they also have a RFP out to relocate the unemployment services office. And I've been having some correspondence with the DCAM commissioner specifically regarding the unemployment RFP because it doesn't really contain the specific restriction that would, you know, require it to stay downtown. So I'm concerned about DCAM awarding that lease outside of the downtown, and I'm extremely concerned that we'd be able to work with DCAM to keep the district attorney downtown, which I think is a critical, critical need. So I think we somewhat have to look at this in the context of several properties and agencies that DCAM is going to ultimately have the control as to whether they stay downtown or not. But again, I think we all agree on these, that we need these agencies to stay downtown. We need DCAM to award leases that will keep them downtown. The district attorney has said repeatedly that he will stay downtown, but in terms of the unemployment office, as I say, I do have some correspondence into Commissioner Gladstone because the language in the RFP does not specifically require it to stay downtown. And that is a big concern.
Thank you, Mayor.
Councilor Moynihan.
Yes, good evening, Mr. Mayor. So I know at the beginning you guys really couldn't get in the contract or agreement that we couldn't, if that didn't go through, that we wouldn't get the building back. Now in your talks with the governor now as far as if we're going to get it or not, is that subject being brought up to look at, we had the agreement, it's going to come downtown, now at the end of the day you're not going to do it and you're going to leave us standing here with our pants down.
Right. I just, and again, I understand the concern. Not sure I'm sure about the analogy, but I understand the concern.
You understand that.
I just think that, I think our discussions right now are 100% positive in trying to all pull in the same direction towards getting this school downtown. And I just feel like we would send the wrong signal if we started saying we're going to, you know, jump up and down till we get our parcel back when they haven't said that they won't build a school here. Now, maybe it'll take a little bit longer. Maybe it may not be exactly the same thing. But I think we're right in the thick of fighting for a downtown school, and I think it's important enough that it's worth the work that we're all putting into it. And by no means is it just myself. I want to be clear that the three colleges and our three state reps are all working together on this.
Right. I just want to make sure that, and I think everybody here on the council wants to make sure that, if it comes to, and hopefully everything's going to go through, everything will be fine, you're working behind the scenes and you have to do that, but that if it comes to a point where they're coming to you and saying, you know, I don't think this is coming, that we're going to be there trying to fight either to get it back or to
right.
have a say in what is going
right.
to be.
Right. I think at that point then, you know, we're all trying to agree on what the highest and best future use for the property is. It's an extremely distressed property that is in a key location for the redevelopment of downtown.
Right, and I'm sure, like you say, if we still owned it, I don't know how much longer that building could be standing without us having to spend that money to tear it down ourselves, so
it's,
I understand.
It, exactly, and that's okay. one of our concerns.
Thank you.
Councilor Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I want to thank the mayor. I do want to tell you guys that the city website assesses that building for a little under $500,000, $487,000 is assessed value for that building as it stands today, as is. My question actually, and I will eventually make a motion to continue this, postpone it, and my thought would be to give the mayor 2 months, and it could be revisited with the new legislative session in January. If I'm fortunate enough to be reelected, this would be the first resolve that I will file. again, but that would give 8 weeks to continue the discussion. But I do think that we need to do something. But I think after the holidays and into the new year would be more appropriate. But with that, if I could ask the solicitor two questions.
Thank you, Counselor.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Mayor.
Attorney Nezarel, good evening.
Good evening.
Relative to the purchase and sale, Phil, was there any warranties or representations that specifically, explicitly survived the delivery of the deed?
No.
Nothing at all?
No.
Okay.
The obligations terminate with the acceptance of the deed.
They did, upon conveyance. Could you?
I looked for that.
Okay. Yeah, I was thinking maybe. Could you, at some point, or somebody in your office, maybe just email the council, copy the current deed?
I will have that done tomorrow. I'll send it to the chairperson.
That'd be great. Thank you very much. Mr. Chairman, if there's no other questions, I am going to continue to make a motion to postpone till the last FinCom in December.
Motion been made and seconded that we postpone to the last FinCom in December. All in favor of that? Opposed? Goes to the last meeting in FinCom meeting in December.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mayor and Attorney Nezarel as well. Item number 11, Madam Clerk.
Resolved that the City Council hereby requests that a representative and or representatives of Aquaria appear before the Finance Committee to address questions pertaining to the desalinization water contract. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Philip Nezarella, City Solicitor, Larry Rowley, DPW Commissioner, Moises Pariante, General Manager, Aquaria Water, Peter Fairbanks, President of Aquaria, and Andrew Kahn, Attorney for Wilmer, Cutler, Pickering, Hale, and Doerr, LLP.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. And two correspondence that I did receive, one of which was from Moises Pariante, indicating that Alfredo Andres will be attending the FinCom meeting on behalf of Aquaria. And Moises Pariante made note that he will not be cooperating with us from now on, that Alfredo Andres will be coordinating with us. The other one is also from the attorney Cohen, indicating that he was not able to attend, or he was instructed not to attend by his client, so he would not be coming this evening, just following the instructions from his client. Councilors, as you know, at the last meeting, again, it got postponed because of information that we were waiting for, which we did receive prior to that. You also received a three-ring binder. But what you also received were these, not we, the city clerk received, I should say, that afternoon, these three books right here, to tell us and give us the information we were looking for.
What is that?
I have to say, when I went into the clerk's office and I asked the clerk, could I see the information pertaining to Aquaria, he said, Council President, they're right there in the chair. They were sitting in the chair.
Awesome.
Okay. But let's go back to when we did ask for information pertaining to the Aquaria contract and the water situation, that we also were told that any time we receive any information, we'd receive 11 different correspondents, or each one would receive one, and I just cannot see how we only received one. The other case, we received, everybody received a book. This is okay, but when I looked at it and I fathomed in my own mind and even talked with the clerk and one other counsel was with me at that point in time, I said, now what do we do? Do we move these books around? I'll start with Councilor Cruz. He's in Ward 1. Let him have them for 3 nights and put them on his kitchen table. Then move it forth and then come to my house. Or do I invite people over? How do we get this done? How do I get it done? How do we get it done? How do we, as a city council, get this done to look at all this information when we are a city council? You do not see, gentlemen, and I wish your Moises was here, but you do not see where we have any other staff, the council that works with the council. The city clerk works for us. He's our clerk. He's our secretary. I couldn't say to him, Mr. Clerk, forget what you got to do in the office today. Anyone comes in that wants to be married, too bad, you ruined their honeymoon. We got this to do. I'm not trying to make a joke of it either, but still, I was very disenchanted when I saw this. I really, really was. So even with the other council who was with me, I said, what do I do? Do I have a special meeting? What I look forward to trying to have, and I can appoint as president of the council, a subcommittee of maybe four people, and they take a look at it, all the information, and pull out what we need, and then they come back and make a report back to the full council. But still, time-consuming. people need to understand, and I know we're looking and been looking for this information, but we just do not have staffing and able to pull all the information together, and I just find that this was just a little bit of a rude situation. It was almost like just handing me a dictionary and say, okay, start looking up the words, but I was not happy with it, and I don't know how my other colleagues feel about it. That's my personal take on it. I will allow a couple of councilors. I know Councilor Sullivan's had this resolved before us for a couple of years, and I did indicate even to him this evening that maybe what we will do is put a subcommittee together. He'd have to file a resolve, and I would put a subcommittee together with four people, and probably he as chair, if that's what the council seems to think that they want to do, so that we can get through this here to give us the information we need. And then at that point in time, naturally, we want to get it done before the end of our legislative year, because we're all up for re-election, and our terms end December 31st. At this point, I'll take and listen to a few councils to what they think, but I just want you people to know, as not only chair of the Finance Committee, but as president of the City Council, I just think that this was very, very inappropriate to do to us, because I just felt, I feel like, you know, they were given to the clerk, and there's the poor clerk holding on to three books, and you know, I come along and he says, there it is. Well, where do I start? Where do I start? And all I can say, and I keep saying, I wasn't here when this thing was passed.
That's right.
I wasn't here. There's only one council that was involved when this was passed, and he's not even here this evening. I would have never passed it.
Neither would I.
Because as a city councilor, I would have never, ever in my life given up my authority for 20 years to never have a say in this contract every two or three years from that point. And that was, and anyone can say what they want, but shame on them for letting that happen, because that's the situation we're in now when we want to review it and look at what we're dealing with in place of the $6.3 million. And I don't know where that's going to go yet either. And, you know, we're going to have to deal with it somehow. But anyhow, that's, and I said it right from the podium, and if anyone didn't like that, councils, I'm sorry, but it needed to be said, because I was very, very disenchanted with what was here. So I'm just at this point protecting you as a city council. That's what I was trying to do. So in any case, Councilor Sullivan, it was your resolve.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Ward 3 Councilor for articulating a lot of the same sentiments that I have. And gentlemen, I want to thank you both for coming here again tonight. I remember, Mr. Andres, you were here, I believe, 4 years ago when I initially filed the resolve, and you came and you were a gentleman. However, we didn't have the information. And so fast forward 4 years later, and, you know, Mr. Parente, I know he relocated to Mexico, but he did assure us that he would be attending these meetings. And, okay, business sense or whatever, he's not coming anymore. Okay, so you're here, unfortunately or fortunately, I don't know which. But what I will say is 2 weeks ago, I was pretty ticked off due to the fact that, again, and I didn't know the magnitude of the volumes, but to deliver materials the morning of a meeting is just unprofessional and uncalled for. But with that being said, when I went down to the clerk's office with the council president, I was actually shocked at the magnitude of three volumes, number one, with no summarization. The cover letter actually didn't even CC the city council. It CC'd the clerk and the mayor, and I think DPW, but the city council wasn't even mentioned on that. At the end of the day, gentlemen, my simple resolve 4 years ago, and again, this legislative session, was, could you explain to us two things? How have you marketed it, and who have you marketed it to? Simple, right? Your legal counsel came before us. I know he's not here tonight, and he opined and gave us an opinion that it had been, and he listed the municipalities and the private enterprises. He also opined and gave us representation that there was some marketing material, brochure or whatever it was, right, when you had the initial face-to-face meetings. But when I went to the clerk's office and I saw that, I said to myself, you got to be kidding me. This is an absolute joke, because this is not my full-time job, right? It's nobody's full-time job being a city council. We treat it that way. But I could have taken that home 2 weeks ago and I'd still be vetting it out, still reading it. And I'm only one of 11. So to only have one volume of three sets was confusing to me, because it's not fair to the whole body not to have appropriate files for each elected official, right? I'm an at-large counselor, Councilor Stewart is, Councilor Barnes, Councilor Rodriguez, but then there's district ward counselors. So we all report to the voters, but I can't report to anybody
because I can't even understand some of the messages that are in there. So I'm very, very dismayed. I've said it before, and I'm going to be very calm today, as my wife told me, be very calm, because at the end of the day, we have a business relationship, right, and an obligation to have a win-win situation, right? You're marketing it, and the only customer you have is the city of Brockton, and we're paying for that. But what really stymies me and stupefies me is the fact that it's taken 4 years to get that, number one, okay? And then there was some statement made, well, we kind of blew you off for a year, year plus, because we were negotiating a potential acquisition by the mayor. Okay, whatever, I think that's bogus, because you didn't come when Mayor Balzotti was not negotiating with you. So let's put that aside, okay? And Cards on the Table says that there's nobody up here, and I don't care what your skill set is. I happen to be a lawyer, but you don't have to be a rocket scientist to understand that you can't dissect that in 2 weeks, never mind 24 hours, never mind the morning of the meeting. So had I seen that the morning of, I would have exploded that night, because I would have personally taken that as a front. There's no way in hell you could ever vet that out in 12 hours. So what I'm going to ask you gentlemen, and again, I'm an attorney and I know you have legal counsel, so I'm not going to go on that, but I think perhaps it would be a really good professional relationship with the city council, the elected legislative body, and you as an enterprise with the city of Brockton, to do what you did 2 weeks ago, but give each one of us a copy of that volume, the three sets. You did that before in the other packets that you gave us. I think the file was about that big. Each one of us got one, which was great. And that spelled out the municipalities and the industries you talked to. But within that, and I said it 2 weeks ago, and I'll say it again, within that, you could have just probably satisfied me by the fact that you should have included the marketing materials in there. So to give us this, again, I think was kind of a slap in the face. I appreciate what you did, and someone spent a lot of time compiling that. But it's somewhat of a waste of resources, because not one of us is able to vet that out. So with that, that's all I wanted to say. I truly appreciate you guys coming here. It's probably a broken record, but a simple solution is, how did you market it, and who did you market it to? I think the who you marketed to has been met because of that original, but you guys have to appreciate the fact that there's nobody up here that could vet that out. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Cruz, then Councilor Barnes.
Thank you. A little bit echo my colleague's concerns. I did take a little bit of time before tonight's meeting and look through that. And to go back to the beginning, this resolve by Councilor Sullivan asked two simple questions. And in the last time that Mr. Parente was here, the contract calls for you to spend a certain amount of money on marketing. It was a very simple question, and all I brought it down to that. Show me where you spent that money, and my vote will be to release the $6 million and move forward. I looked through those volumes, and I hate to think, I hate to be a cynic, but I can tell you that, first of all, the first two volumes are strictly concerned with why we have a desal plant and how the process worked for building it, negotiating it, why Brockton got to the point where it needed it. That was not part of the questions that were asked. I look at that, and I look through it, and I have to tell you that if I were a cynic, I'd think all you were trying to do was baffle us with bull, and I'll leave the rest unsaid. That is strictly there to try and get us all flustered and look through and say, oh, there's so much stuff, I don't even know what's here. I hate to think that a partner of mine would work like that, but I have to tell you, when I look through those three volumes tonight, and there is, the largest volume talks about who you marketed to. As I went through it, it shows many towns, it shows some private ventures that were marketed to. That's what we were looking for, although I have to tell you that I saw undated letters, unsigned letters in there. I think the thought was, if we give them so much, they won't be able to look through it. And again, I hate to think like that, but I was really angry when I was looking through that. Again, the first two volumes have nothing to do with the questions that this body has been asking. We understand that the state came in years ago and said you'll have a second source of water. We understand all those things. That's not what the questions that this resolve has asked for and that we've been trying to get answered for 2 or 3 years now. The question is, have you fulfilled the requirements of the contract on how much money you've spent to market the project? Your attorney came in a month or so ago and went on and on about how the business, it's changed, and is, we understand that. But that's not our problem, just like the fact that we don't need as much of the water anymore is not your problem. We're all in this place, but that is an absolute slap in the face to every councillor here, and it still doesn't answer the question, which gets me concerned that you can't answer the question properly, which is why you're trying to just throw so much stuff at us. And again, I hate to think like that. I'm generally not the cynic, and these people will tell you. I'm usually the one that says, oh, I'm sure they're doing their best. But that delivery was a slap in the face to this council, in my opinion, and was purposely done to try and just deluge part-time city councilors with so much information that they couldn't, we wouldn't be able to get through it. And the fact that the round 11 copies, we were specifically told you'd get 11, we'd get a copy each of any future correspondence. And Mr. Parente, who, you know, conveniently isn't with you anymore, or isn't in this, the same job, is the one who promised us that, as did Mr. Cohen, I believe. But that, I take, as a direct slap in the face. I will go through that third volume, and I'll find, look at all those towns and all the information, but again, much of what I saw is undated, unsigned, and it's redundant presentations, and I still can't get an answer. Did we spend, I believe it's $250,000 to market? It's a pretty simple question, and it's a pretty simple answer you should be able to give us after all these years, and the fact that you cannot show us that makes me wonder whether you have spent that money and whether we have to stick with this contract. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank you, Councilor.
Chairman.
Councilor Barnes.
Yes, you know, just to echo my colleagues a little bit, but to go on a different plane. As they've said, we were told that we would get the additional information. It was delivered. That's all been hashed and rehashed earlier. But I find it odd that you can deliver 11 copies that refer to, you know, some pieces in the contract about us paying you. You can get that to us in a timely fashion and get it to everybody, but you can't get the information that you've been asked for since at least I've been here and, you know, for years previous. You can't do that. And I find it, I don't know if I'm angry or amazed, but either you gentlemen or representatives from the Aquaria, you all come here and you allow yourself to be fricasseed by this body every week. You come here, and I don't really understand, like, do you go back and kind of say, like, oh, you know, we got over that one, and do you agree before you come in here, and we're just going to let them yell at us, and then we're going to go back and do whatever we want to do? And another thing, too, it's kind of, it's not funny, ha-ha, but it's funny, ironic, that this particular, I find that my job here is to be a fact-finding, you know, participant, and this particular issue has turned into, it's not even a dialogue, like, they're just monologues from all of the counselors. Nobody ever says anything. There are no questions for you all. The same question that's been asked millions of times never gets answered. So it really is, it's redundant and foolish for us to continue to ask you these same questions, because guess what? We know you're not going to answer. And I guess I'm going to go back to the question format. How dare you? Really? What is your thought process when you come in here and you know, before you come in here, that you all have just pretty much, you know, given us the big, you know, single salute, single finger salute in here? How dare you? I'd like an answer.
Well, there are several answers and several questions that have been raised by the councillors. And first is that I believe there were many documentation required, not only about the marketing purposes, but including brochures, including contracts, including, so I believe all of that was asked, and that's what we have provided. We have provided contracts that were discussed with many communities and were not signed at the end. For example, the contract with the town of Norton, we spent many years with them designing the contract. It was contingent upon having a pipeline approved by Mass Highway. It was not approved finally, so it was not signed. But we have included that contract there. That contract took lawyers' expenses, and took many negotiations with the town of Norton, as well as many other communities. So we have included all that documentation. We thought that it was better not to leave anything unresponded. So we included brochures, we included events that we did throughout in Brockton or in Dighton, like as the pilot plant event, where we invited many of the decision makers in the water business, like water superintendents or water departments. We did a piloting event where we invited all those. We did a groundbreaking event where we invited all the stakeholders on the water business. We included all that information as well. And then we included one list of a different chapter for every community that we have worked with. And they have been like 25 communities, every single community that was within the reach of the water plant. Many of those, then we realized, like north of Brockton, even Braintree, that they were not technically feasible to send water from Dighton to Braintree. Other communities, the ones that are from Dighton to Brockton, there were, we built the pipeline. We dedicated a lot of time with them to discuss the connection points for water deliveries. We even built water connections for the town of Easton that was ultimately, we didn't got into an agreement with Easton. So there was a lot of effort involved in selling water to all these communities. Unfortunately, as Mr. Cohn explained when he was here, the Department of Environmental Management changed some of the regulations and made it even more difficult to sell water. So that's why we are where we are. But I think those three volumes include all of that, so we won't leave anything out of the discussion. We included at the beginning a letter. That letter, 7-8 pages, included a summary of the background event so that everyone would understand what has been going for the last 10 years with the project, why we are where we are, and what have been our marketing efforts. Which unfortunately for the city of Brockton, unfortunately for Aquaria, we haven't got any new customer. But I think that letter explains, and just by seeing that we have worked with every single community, 25 plus independent or other private entities, I think, and the letter says that we have spent almost $1 million in marketing the water for all these communities. Regarding the volumes, there are three. There are big volumes. We even didn't know how to work with them. If all of you wanted just to have a box in your office, or this would be a documentation to be available somewhere at the city, what I suggest is that we can provide either another 11 volumes. Three volumes or electronic copies for you so that you can look at
Mr. Chair, I would like my copy electronically, please. Please don't give me those volumes. I would like it electronically, please. Thank you.
When the decision's made, I'll make sure that
Thank
happens,
you.
Counselor. Go, continue.
Yeah, if you can.
Well, I think that's basically it. I think the purpose of the documentation was not going one by one with
me.
We send an email to this person. That took us 15 minutes. This cost us $500. We made this meeting with this water department. It cost us $1,000 and just add everything up to $250,000. That is not what the contract says. Anyway, we don't have to prove that we spend it. We just have to spend it. I think it's in our best interest, in Aquarius' interest, to market the water. And I think that information, when you review it, I think anyone can realize that there has been a very big effort in marketing the water to every community that we could technically possibly send water.
Okay, my last statement. To me, that looks like, you know how in movies and things when somebody tries to get over and they have the suitcase full of phone books and they got the money on top? That's what that looks like to me.
That's
exactly what it looks
from,
like.
Councilor Cruz, and that I can tell you that was not the intent. The intent was to provide every documentation, brochures, contract work that we have done with communities, and we don't want to leave anything. We wanted just to put everything on a package, separated, organized by communities or by contracts, by brochures, so that everything was there, and we wouldn't have to come back and say, well, you didn't include the brochures, or we told you bring contracts or legal work that you have done with other communities.
So to summarize, in my finite mind, I'm just going to say that that is a chronology of your failure to do your job and to hold up to your end of the bargain that the city of Brockton entered in with you. So, I mean, at this particular point, I'm willing to kind of take the fine and continue to not pay you or whatever, or take the, that's just my opinion, to take whatever kind of interest and all that other stuff, because that's ridiculous. That's absolutely ridiculous. And like Council Carew said, like, there's no way you can have a reliable partnership if one of the partners feels like they're being taken advantage of, or that their collective intelligence is being insulted every single time a request is made. It's, I don't know. But again, like I said, you can definitely pick out, you know, points in the contract when you're asking for your money, and we all got the letter. So, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor Barnes. Councilor Moynihan.
Thank you. Good evening, gentlemen. Good evening. I'll be the nice guy for a second.
Always.
All right, so say you spent $1 million on marketing. There's been problems trying to market it now because the state has changed regulations, what have you. So all that behind us, what happens now? Where are you going with the marketing? What's going on?
Well, you know, water, selling water is not like selling vacuum cleaners. We cannot go every water commission to the city or the town of Easton and just by hammering them, buy me water. If they don't need water, they don't buy water, no matter how many times we go there. So, you know, the communities that are most likely to get water are those communities that are directly linked to the pipeline, which are the town of Dighton, town of Easton, town of West Bridgewater, city of Taunton, and Rainham. We have two connections with Rainham. We're still working with them every now and then. We keep a close contact with them. We still evaluate what are the water needs for the communities. And we were in permanent contact with them, because just because we have a pipeline through their towns, every time we do flushing or something, we're in very close contact. Those are the communities that are most likely to get water. We have been working lately, beginning of the year, with the Tri-Town development, with others that are likely to get water. Those communities that are definitely north of Brockton, the water rates, the new legislation, the wheeling, the cross liability with Brockton make it impossible to sell water to them. So we're focusing on those communities that we have already connections, that they only need to get a permit and we open the valve. Those are the ones that we're working with.
Okay, so when you're doing all this stuff and you're trying to work with these communities, are you updating the DPW, the mayor's office, on what is going on and what you're doing? Or is this a... is this just you doing this yourselves and nobody, you know, we're not being informed, or the mayor's office or the DPW is not being informed about it?
From time to time, as a matter of fact, I was 3 weeks ago with the Water Commission, just giving them an update. And our intent is to keep on going to the Water Commission every other month. Typically, we go there and we update them on what's the status of the plant. What is the Brockton water requirements for the next quarter, and what have been our marketing efforts. Yeah. So our intent is to continue that.
Okay, now, those three volumes over there, can you put that into something that's a little easier for us to look at, summarize it? I mean, like they've all said, it's been sort of simple questions. How much have you spent marketing? Who have you marketed to? I don't think we need three volumes to see that, all that. Can you make that a little little condensed for us all, maybe, instead of having all that, so each council could have something with that? I mean, there's not that many towns, so I don't think there's too much information you need to put other than maybe some dates, when you did it, how much you spent. Simple. Can you come up with something that's a little summarized? Other than that's just
sure.
Go through all
sure.
that. It might be a little easier.
Yeah, I can prepare a summary of that. knowing that it won't include all the brochures or all the contract, but it will be a summary of we have worked with this town, we met with them on this month of this year, and they decided not to take water, or we met with this other town, and here's where we are with this town. So I can prepare like a small 20-page summary so that you can read and then have those three volumes as a reference for appendices to that
okay.
summary.
Okay, how long do you think that will take?
You can get it in the next within the next 2 weeks.
Okay, and so when Councilor Sullivan asked for this 4 years ago, we still hadn't got it. That's a simple thing. I think that's the frustration everybody has. What I just asked you was simple, what he had, and we can do it in 2 weeks. So I think that's the frustration that the council has, and Councilor Sullivan, of course, who's had filed this resolve. So let's get that within 2 weeks for us, please, and hopefully we can get a few answers. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Dubois.
Hi, gentlemen. Did you give your presentation? Did you come in with the presentation that you haven't given yet? I'm just asking. Great. All right. Can we just drill down a little bit into the weeds on why didn't you get the Weymouth Naval Station? Why didn't you get them? Like, what happened with that? So are you familiar with the Weymouth Naval Station?
Pretty familiar. Are you familiar with that?
Yes, it's
the right. Yeah, no, I know the tri-town. I know that years ago we have been working with them and you have all the documentation there from.
So you're familiar with the Weymouth Naval Air Station, how
yes.
they're developing
yes, and,
into
yes,
into single-family homes and housing.
Yeah, there was a study done about all the alignments to get water from the plant, which is in Dighton. To the naval base.
So it comes to Brockton. Your water comes to Brockton, and Weymouth is one town away. So you would have to build a pipeline. But instead, they're going to build a pipeline, I think, across three towns and get their water from MWRA. So I would like to know what you did to get the Weymouth Naval Air Force, the Naval Air Force Base project. Why didn't you win that? Why did you lose it?
Well, at the
when
end,
we're closer and it would have been cheaper to get water from us.
Well, maybe it was cheaper to do the pipeline, but you know, Brockton is close to the town, but this doesn't mean that you can cross the line and just put a pipeline connection.
Are you talking about inter-basin transfers? Is that what you mean
no,
by
I'm
a pipe
about,
and put a line?
About just the technicals of putting a pipeline and connecting from the northwestern,
right.
Northeastern part of Brockton to Weymouth is the next time.
Mm-hmm.
They are very small pipelines there, so the pipeline doesn't go directly from that portion in Brockton to the next pipeline. There are miles that have to be built between the main line that comes south east of Brockton to the connected, not just to the
so
very
what was
beginning
your
of the
town. Did you make a presentation to
yes.
the Weymouth, how long ago was that?
It was in 2004, I believe. Then we met with them in 2005, several years. And we have included a cost analysis with what would cost from water, from Aquaria water, and what would be the cost from NWRA.
So you did an analysis of the two?
Yeah, and we shared it with them.
And what do you think? What was the nut of the analysis? Was it going to be what?
Well, the price was very close.
Very
close.
So why did you lose?
It was different because they had a lower rate, but they had to pay an upfront cost.
Much higher, which still hasn't been determined.
Yeah, we didn't have an upfront cost, but then they had to pay a higher rate.
Right.
They decided to go with MWRA.
When did you make that presentation, the last presentation that you've made with them?
I don't remember. I believe it was done. Do you remember?
I think it's 2006.
2006,
because they just made their determination, I want to say, like it was in the media a month and a half ago. So since from 2006 to 2015, The biggest project for water, who didn't have water and was searching for water, your company never went out and tried to get their business again from 2006 to 2015.
Well,
I almost feel like you're a corporate rent seeker. That's what I think is happening. Yeah. I think you have your contract for $6 million. You get enough money to run the operation. You have enough money for your investors. You're just trickling along, keeping your jobs going, and you're not really trying to win anything. See, I want to win. I don't want to sit around and keep losing and paying for this existence of killing fish eggs and ruining our environment and running this plant and wasting all this energy for nothing. Do you understand how is that fulfilling for your company? For the people that work every day to be working and struggling and want to be proud of what they do, and I want them to be proud of what they do, to create drinkable water for people that need to drink water to survive, they should be proud of what they're doing, and instead they're wasting all that energy, they're pumping it to Brockton, and they're dropping it in the river to go right back down to be cleaned and waste all that energy and all that human capital to pump it to Brockton, to dump it in the river. That is the definition of corporate rent seeking. I mean, what are you producing? What are you producing right now down there? Just tell me.
I don't think that's the case with Aquaria.
What are you producing?
You know, we have maybe the last presentation was in 2006, but we have been talking with Tri-Town as far as I would need to check the documentation, but at least as far as 2 years ago with them. And at that point, we saw that it was not viable, that it was more expensive to bring water from Dighton to the Tri-Town than from MWRA. And that was finally their decision. They had the two options, and they decided for MWRA.
I wish we decided for MWRA 20 years ago, and we wouldn't be in this frivolous, ridiculous corporate rent-seeking contract that we're in right now. I mean, even the people at your work, I mean, are you there every day?
Not
every day. Are either you gentlemen there every day? Are you there every day?
No.
Okay. So do you know the people that work there? Have you talked to them?
Sure.
Don't you think it's kind of have you ever worked in a project like this personally, like hands-on a project like this, day in and day out? Either of you?
Can you repeat?
Have you ever worked in a water desalinization plant?
Yes.
On a regular basis?
Sure.
Day in and day out.
Yeah, and you know, we're not happy with the situation.
And have you, sir? Have you worked at a desalinization plant? You have not. But so you've worked somewhere, though, and you know the value and the pride of producing something and knowing where that goes, be it safety, security, government, good government, McDonald's hamburger, whatever it is, you take pride in what you produce. And then you pump it to a city, and you dump it in the river, and it goes back down for you to clean it out again, for you to pump it to the city, for you to dump it in the river. All that energy that's being wasted, and in Massachusetts we have such an energy problem that we're talking about expanding pipelines and taking hydro energy at millions and billions of dollars and paying for offshore wind, and we have a desalinization plant that's utilizing so much energy just to pump water to Brockton, poor, low-income community of color that has been raped by this stupid contract, for you to dump that water
Counselor.
Right in front of our face
Counselor,
into
Counselor.
The river, and it goes back to Dighton again.
Counselor, settle down
Thank
a little
you.
Bit. Settle down a little
but
bit.
But it's just, it's the term, the word is offensive, I'm sorry. But the what's happening here in Brockton is offensive. And I'm not saying it's either of your faults. It's not our fault because we didn't sign this contract. But what is happening here is we need that Aquaria to take more pride in their work, that they actually want to win. I didn't come here. We don't come here Monday nights to make Brockton a better place to lose and be corporate paying people salaries to have water brought to our community that we could drink, that we could give to our people and drop it in the river for it to go back down and be cleaned again and brought back to Brockton and dropped in front of our faces in the river. It is really Sisyphean and really corporate welfare at its worst. So I really hope that you'll leave here and don't feel bad about us, don't feel bad about yourself, but we really need some more teamwork here. We need people to take pride in their work. We want the people at that Dighton plant to realize that what they're doing is important because they're giving people drinkable water, which is critical for everybody. and not just drop it in the river in Brockton. It's just such an embarrassment all around what's happening here.
Well, I have 2 points to
please.
I think 2 important facts. First is that for the last month we have been delivering water to Brockton at a rate of 1 million gallon per day, and we're delivering water as we speak.
Yeah.
3 months ago in summer when there was that outburst,
right.
We started the plant within less than 2 hours.
Which was great.
We put it at 100% and resolved one of the biggest problems. I think that's the purpose of the plant is not as the main water supplier, but as the secondary water resource. And we don't dump water into the river. We just, when we don't deliver water to Brockton, we just keep the pipeline moving water. We're not dumping water.
Well, it goes somewhere. I've been told it dumps in the river over where, I don't know exactly where. I was
but
at a water commission
meeting and they talked
about it.
The pipeline.
Yes,
otherwise
of course
it will
you
freeze.
Do.
Otherwise it won't be available clean to deliver
needed.
Water when there's an emergency.
Even if you don't need water from us, you need to keep the plant running. Yeah. Everybody understands once it's built, you have to keep it working or it's going to totally fall, and then the whole institution and the whole product and the whole sham is going to blow up in smoke, and we're all going to see it for what it is. But what I want to do is I want to know, we had a really great opportunity to win Weymouth Naval Air Force Base. Norwood, another good opportunity. And so now I'm a new state representative. I've been a city councilor for 10 years. I was not here when this contract signed. I would have never voted for it. I would have seen it for the corporate welfare that it is. But we're in this situation now. And when you said that you lost Norwood because Mass Highway wouldn't approve the project.
Norton.
So I'm a state representative now. Before you leave, I'm going to give you my card. When you have these projects, you should talk to me, and I can call those departments. And why that didn't happen before, I have no idea. Every time Aquaria comes here, I say, I'm a city councilor. Take my card. If you want me to come with you to pitch something to another selectman or another city councilor, you should bring one of us. And that collegial relationship might actually get you something, if that's what you really want. But by ignoring the partnership that you're given every time, not you personally, but the corporation is given every time they come here, from me and my fellow colleagues to help you pitch this, to help you make this work, and then these binders that say that you did something on paper, when you have a human being that could have easily made a phone call to the Mass Highway Department, and we had, when you were really trying to wheel this, the Brockton delegation had so much juice at the State House that we don't have now. Because God has taken one of our wonderful Senator Tom Kennedy, and we have a lot of new state reps coming in. You had a great opportunity with a lot of people that had a lot of respect, and you never even asked us to help. So even right there, it's like you want to fail because this is corporate welfare, and as soon as the contract is over, that place is going to close unless we buy it, and then it's our responsibility to close it down, which I hope no one ever does up here because that would just be even dumber of us. I just want you to leave here with redouble your efforts. We want to be winners. We don't want to be losers. We don't want corporate welfare. We want the people that work at that Dighton plant to have pride in their work and to actually have drinking water that goes into people's stomachs and not down some river. So I hope this is a good pep talk for you. And you can get out there. I'll give you my business card. And I think that you should call. And if you don't call me, call somebody to go to these meetings with you and help you pitch them. Because there's obviously a disconnect. Because MWRA won that contract. And I don't think it's just about the money, because MWRA still doesn't know how much they're going to charge them for the hookup fee. They still don't know the whole cost. And they got that contract contingent on the naval base getting all the connections it needs, getting the intra-transfers, and getting everything they did. You could have gotten that. Why didn't you get it? Like, that's from my point of view. We're paying you $6 million, and you can't get this? Then what can you get? At what point do we lose faith in your ability to run your part of the deal? That's what I'm saying. Show me something. So that's all I got to say. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Just to another fact to respond to your corporate welfare that you are talking about, Aquaria is losing money at a rate of millions of dollars per year. We have included the
maybe you should go bankrupt
DPU,
down there.
Yeah, we have included
Please
the DPU
do.
Results And the feelings we do, we're not happy with this situation. We know that the only way to turn this around is by getting new customers.
Right.
We're the most interested in getting new customers.
Your partner's right here, waiting to help you.
I appreciate it, yeah.
Okay.
And you know, like, sometimes when you actually talk to a selectman from Weymouth who you knew because your cousin used to live in Weymouth and they played baseball together, it's a little bit easier to make a deal than when you have all people that have no connection to anybody trying to pitch something. So that's something you guys probably already know, but I'll just remind you of that. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Counselor. Thank you. Counselor Rodriguez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Fairbanks, what do you do for work? I know it says that you're the president of Aquaria, but are you a businessman or?
I have a company that does energy conservation.
Okay.
For commercial and industrial facilities.
Let me ask you a question, and this is just as a businessman. You've got this product that you're trying to sell to these other communities. And those communities are in touch with what goes on in Rockton because our relationship has been in the paper quite often. Aquaria showing up, Aquaria not showing up, another question, money's being held and all this other stuff. So it's in the paper, it's in the public eye and people know about this. As a businessman, do you think that those communities are going to be jumping for joy to sign a contract to work with your company, knowing that this relationship, this type of a relationship that existed between us, do you think that's going to be a catalyst to get those people to sign up to work with you guys, knowing what we're going through with you? Honestly, as a business person on the other side of things, do you think that you would jump onto signing a contract knowing that what we're going through with you now, that you would be doing the same thing possibly to your next customers?
Well, I think they'd make their decision primarily based on economics.
No, I'm asking you as a business person. Would you do that?
Me as a business person, if I would do what?
If you would buy into a product, knowing that that product, that the people who are involved in that partnership has had the history that we have had with Aquaria. Would you buy into that?
Excuse me, just one second. Could you just stand in front of the microphone so all the councilors could hear? Thank you.
Personally, I think that Aquaria has fulfilled its contract and is continuing to fulfill its contract. We were signed on to be your alternate water source and be there if something like the major pipe break happened. And as Alfredo said, the plant responded and delivered the water. So, I mean, we're there. If Brockton wants to buy the water, they can, and they, in fact, are today. So to answer your question, if I was a community looking for water and, you know, the economics were such that it made sense for me to do it because I didn't have other alternatives, then I would.
But what I'm saying to you is that in lieu of all the relationship that existed between the city of Brockton and Aquaria, I've been on this council for almost 2 years now, and Aquaria has been on the FinCom's agenda every single meeting. And we've had, I think this is the second or third time that I've seen you in 2 years.
Yes.
And we ask you to come every meeting. So knowing, especially when we are the largest city in this region, that these smaller communities look at the larger city to see what's going on, they might be needing water or they might be needing the resources that you are selling, but I don't think they're willing to take the headache that comes along with it. And I think that's why they're seeking out alternative water sources. Does that make sense?
I think in a way it does, yeah.
It does. Well, in the beginning, I know that, Council Sullivan and some of the other folks on this body had actually, had asked two questions, and I'm not going to rehash the two questions, but because of this frustration that exists, I'm actually the one that proposed cutting that funding. And the reason why I'm saying that is that every year that money has to be reappropriated by this council, although it's a contract, there's a contract in place, but every year when we have budget hearings, this body has to reapprove or reappropriate that funding. That's why we were able to cut it. Otherwise, we wouldn't have that opportunity. But what I'm saying to you is, I have received, and I'm sure my other counselors have done the same thing, various correspondences from Aquaria. And just as a courtesy to this body, the mayor has never, that I know of, hasn't asked you any of these questions. The CFO hasn't done any of that. The DPW commissioner has not asked you any of those questions. It's been the city council. Even when you're addressing the letters that come from you, you don't have the decency of addressing the letters to the appropriate bodies that ask you for the information. That, to me, comes back as a sign of disrespect. I don't know if you're aware of this or not, but this is actually a strong council, a weak mayor system, in a representative form of government, which means that when you disrespect us, in reality, you're disrespecting the 100,000 citizens of this city. So when we ask you for information, and you don't have the decency of even addressing the body that asks you for that information, it's disappointing.
I apologize. I wasn't involved in that letter. So.
No, it's not just this letter. It's every single correspondence. Since we cut the funding, every single correspondence that have come from Aquaria has been addressed to a body other than this body. But the cutting happened here, well, and the request actually happened here. So I find it... I don't see how you see that as not being disrespectful. It's almost like I ask you for a question, and you basically decide to give the answer to somebody else. Well, and that, to me, is not a sign. And then it comes back to those communities, again, looking to sign on to you, knowing that you don't... They're smaller communities. They don't even have a mayor. These are towns that you're dealing with. They have councilors or selectmen. And they're looking at it saying, these folks don't give two flying doo-doos about the people, because look what they're doing to the folks in Brockton. So why were they signed on to you?
Well, that was not the intent to be...
But that was the way it came out.
Well, many of the letters were sent, we have a contract and they have notice requirements. So we send the notices, for instance, the notice of non-payment, we send it to the...
But you know that the appropriating body is this body.
Yes.
You know that every year that money gets reappropriated,
and we're
right?
We're going to copy this body in any other further communications with the city.
But again, if I'm asking you to paint the wall purple, shouldn't you answer me with an answer, no, I can't paint it purple because of this, this, and that? Or do you go to the mayor to say, I know he asked for the wall to be painted purple? You see what I'm saying? That it comes back to us when we go back into our communities and the people that we are representing, the people that actually voted for us to be here, to stand up and defend them. It just kind of sends a lousy signal to them. Do you see that?
I see that, and we'll take appropriate measures.
Now, I actually have a couple questions, because I know for a fact I have a full-time job. I speak English as a second language, or maybe actually I speak English as a fifth language, and I'm not going to go through that whole binder because before you know it, I'm going to think you're planning some sort of a conspiracy against me and my folks. So I actually have some questions that perhaps you as the administrator and you as the president of the company can actually just kind of answer for me and the folks that are watching us at home, if that's okay with you.
Sure.
Who owns Aquaria?
It's owned by a Spanish company, Anima.
Yes.
And my company, Bluestone Energy Services.
And is that that 13% that we keep hearing?
Yes. 12.5%, actually.
12.5%. And let me ask you something. What was the total cost of building those facilities? Because I wasn't around back when it happened. And again, I'm not going to go through the book and try to find it because I don't even know where to find it. Do you know what it costs to build that plant?
Well, it included direct costs plus permitting plus engineering. It went up to $96 million.
When you went to the bank to borrow money or whatever to build that facility, how much did you borrow?
95 and change.
95 and change?
Yeah.
Now, we are all aware that since the purchase, I mean, since the construction, that that company has been sold. Yes?
Inima is owned by a Spanish company, which was owned by another Spanish company. Now that other company is a Korean company.
So they sold it to the Korean company?
Yeah, so the great-grandfather is Korean instead of Spanish.
Okay, so what was the sale price of the plant?
Of the company?
The American. I know that we were told that they were part of a 6 plant that was sold. One plant was part of that package. Do you have any idea what was the total, what was the cost?
I don't have an idea of that.
Is there any way you can find that out?
Probably not, because that's pretty confidential. I would be the last one to know.
It might be confidential, but if you're asking me to write you a check in the name of the people of Brockton, you're doing business with a public entity. I don't see how confidential and private that can be.
Yeah, the thing is that it's not, they bought 6 plants. They bought 6 plants, they bought several companies in different countries, so...
They can't tell you how much they bought this plant for?
I don't think they put a price in this plant. They just evaluated all the company. The company has presence in 8 different countries. It has 20 or 30 different subsidiaries, so I don't know how they evaluated the purchase of the project. They are on the, but probably there's not a real evaluation on the project other than the evaluation of the company as a whole. See what I mean?
So you're telling me that you have no idea how much that plant is worth?
I know that it cost $95 million.
Cost $95 million.
Yeah.
Just like my home, when it was built,
yeah,
it cost $360,000. It's now probably worth $200,000. Mm-hmm. I'm saying, in your opinion, how much is that plant worth?
To me, it's worth $95 million.
So it didn't lose any value at all since it was built?
Well, it has lost some. It was built 7 years ago, so it has lost some value.
It has lost some value. So in your eyes, it's no longer worth $95 million, right? Would you say?
Safe to say
that it's not worth $95
million? I don't think that the value of the plant is just the asset of the plant.
If some gazillionaire showed up and says, I want to buy this plant, what would you say in your eyes that plant is worth?
You want to respond? I don't know about that. Maybe you have.
And don't tell me what it's the $88 million, because we know for a fact that it's not worth $88 million.
Well, I think the answer is that the plant is worth what somebody's willing to pay for it on the open market.
That's a good answer. That's a good answer. What is the assessed value of the plant, you know?
I'm sorry?
As far as the town of Dighton, what is the assessed value of the plant?
The assessed value is around $22 million.
$22 million.
But that's basically how much concrete there is, and it's only on the town of Dighton. Then there's the pipeline, which is another $20 million, and there's the engineering, there's all the immaterial value.
$40 million?
I don't know.
$50 million? You don't know? And it's been made very clear to us, and we've heard by multiple sources that you've had some difficulties producing water consistently. We had, a meeting back in before the summer. We had asked, basically, on a 30-day cycle, how many days were you able to produce the maximum quantity of water, and what was that quantity? Do you remember?
I don't remember. I know that we have been delivering water for the last month. And I know that when Brockton required full capacity, the plant was running in 2 hours.
For how many days?
As long as Brockton needed.
Are you saying that you're able to produce, if the city of Brockton asks you to produce 3.5 million gallons of water on a daily basis, let's say for 30 days, you're able to do that for 30 days?
Yes.
You are?
Sure, yeah. We're producing water now, so for more than 1 month. So
And how long does it take you? You said that while we had the emergency, that it basically you're up and running in 2 hours, you're producing water in 2 hours?
Yeah. That's the reason why we keep always some water running through the pipeline coming to that from Lytton to Brockton, just to prevent from freezing we have and to prevent from bacteriological contamination. So we keep a small flow moving so that the plant is ready within 2 hours.
So within 2 hours you can go to produce the maximum quantity of water required by the city?
Yeah.
And you still have no idea how much that plant is worth?
No.
No. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You're welcome, Councillor. Councillor Isaac.
I have a quick question for Mr. Andres, I believe. You stated earlier, Mr. Andres, that you have been speaking to our DPW and our Brockton Water Commission. When did you do that?
That was a month ago or 2 months ago that I was with the Water Commission. 2 months ago.
So you were at one of their meetings, or?
Yeah, you weren't there that day. Yeah, at one of their meetings.
You were at an open meeting?
Yes.
Okay. When was it? You said 2 months ago?
Yes, probably 2 months ago.
Okay.
I don't remember the date, but.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Sullivan?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a couple of quick follow-ups, and then
sure.
I'm going to make a motion if I could. Gentlemen, again, thanks for being here tonight, but I guess my question is just very simple. This would all be for naught if you had 4 years ago produced volume number 3, that book right there. I'm stymied on why it wasn't done at that time. It wouldn't be here right now. With that being said, you agreed to do a 20-page summary or a summarization. You said it would take 2 weeks.
Yeah,
that was to Mr. Monahan.
Next Friday. No, this Friday, following Friday.
Yeah, I mean, I would think, number one, if you're going to do that, then you should really extend your notice as well to the city. Because, again, we're waiting on you, and that's what's triggering this letter relative to the money. So I would think, in good faith, you would hold off on that letter due to the fact that there's some outstanding information you need to supply to us, and you've given yourself a drop-dead date of 2 weeks. Also, I guess I'd like to know if I could. Number one, I'd like myself as a councilor at large and being the generator of this resolve, I would like copies of all three of those books. I'm not sure if my colleagues need volumes 1 and 2 because I concur with the Ward 1 councilor. A lot of that has nothing and is not germane to the resolve or the inherent point of the resolve. However, I think volume 3 should and really should be and could be generated throughout the council, each council member getting one. And I know my colleague and state representative would like it in email format. Two quick questions. Relative to the financial stability and rate of the company, is the financial stability, this has been going on for 4 years, this resolve, so is your company rated the same as it was 4 years ago, or you say you're losing money, $1 million a year or whatever it is, so you're in the red, but is your financial ratings, has that dropped as well?
No.
It hasn't, so that's leveled off, that's stayed.
Yeah, this is
has it increased or is it flat?
I wouldn't know, but this is a small project compared to the company, our company.
Okay. I think the council chairman, who's also the president, he brought up the idea of a subcommittee and a study group, and I think that is an appropriate and it's a well-thought-out idea, Mr. Chairman. What I'm going to do is I'm going to make a motion to postpone this until the first FinCom in December, with the caveat that we get that information, like you said, in 2 weeks, the summarization, because I think that summarization is extremely important. And I also, if you could please give us your view tonight, is it possible for each of us to get volume 3?
Yes, we can provide it either in paper or electronic.
Yeah, hard copy. And then actually maybe we should, through the chair, some of us would want all three copies. I don't know if everybody wants that, Mr. Chair. Maybe it's wise to do that so everyone's on the same field relative to information sharing. So in the form of my motion, councilors, I'm going to make a motion to postpone my resolve, this resolve, to the first FinCom in December, with the stipulations that Aquarius provide to this body a 20-page summary within 2 weeks, and also each individual counselor get respective volumes and sets of volumes. And then also, Mr. Chairman, I'm going to ask that you and your wisdom, in conjunction with our legislative council, also formulate a study committee or study group, however you want to deem it, Mr. Mm-hmm. Chairman, to be able to vet that out and report back. It's within your authority under the charter to do that. It's been done by other previous councilors on other issues, council presidents. So with that being said, I do want to thank you, gentlemen, for being here again tonight, but that is my my motion.
I'll second that, and on the motion.
On the motion, Councilor Cruz.
Thank you. I want to thank Councilor Sullivan, and I just want to make sure we all need to understand, and you need to understand, we can't drag on this, because the fact, the frustration that we've held up this $6 million, we can't, this has to be taken care of by early December, because we could get into some, the idea that if we hold this, you're probably going to sue, but we need to set a tax rate in late December. There are other issues that will become very problematic if this drags, and if you come in, and I know you're not going to, because I can tell there's a new spirit of cooperation here tonight, but it's very important, I'm talking to my colleagues and to you too, that this can't drag, because this can't go beyond that first meeting in December, or we're going to have a real problem with the budget, and we'll be moving into next year, and possibly there are myriad problems if this doesn't get taken care of by then. So we need to, as a group, really feel confident that we're going to have that information and that we can act on that in a timely manner. So please don't, I know the former director down there isn't with us anymore. Let's just say everything was his fault, and you're going to have this here on time, because it is of huge importance that there is no further delay on any of this, because we need to feel like when we vote to release this $6 million, if we do, the time is of the essence, and that's all I want to say.
Well, I agree with that, and if I may, I'm ready not to get this drug any longer and to provide this within 2 weeks, so my commitment is to send tomorrow an email to Mr. Chairman so that he can provide me all your emails and just a list of them, knowing whether you want them on paper or electronic. We'll need to put a SharePoint so that you can just connect and just look at it or download it. That would be the easiest way, an immediate way that we can do it tomorrow, a SharePoint so that everyone can log in and see all the documentation, or someone wants paper, we can send paper within 2 weeks. And we're ready to come, not on December, but on the next Finance Committee in November, just to get the same discussion, see if we have addressed your comments, and see if the appropriation can be approved at that
point. Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Sullivan.
I'm going to modify that date. I said the first FinCom in December. I am, in a show of good faith, going to say the second FinCom in November. However, I think in a show of good faith with Aquaria, this letter that was generated tonight relative to a demand should be held in abeyance due to the fact that you're giving us 2 weeks relative to generating the document. So do I have, from the two of you, your executives, is that going to be a show of good faith? You're going to hold off on this?
Yes.
All right. You heard that for the record. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. That's my motion. It was properly seconded.
Motion was made and seconded.
Mr. Chairman.
We're moving it now until... Yes, Councilor.
On the motion.
Yes, go ahead.
I actually had it written in here. I just need to, for my own record, what is your annual operating cost?
That's not part of the...
Mr. Chairman, just give me a little leeway here.
That's not part of the motion, Councilor. It's not part of the motion. We're setting
not part of the motion.
It's not part of the motion about the operating.
It's in the book, Mr. Chairman. That's why I'm asking that. You know, it's a simple question. I mean, it's in the book. We're talking
okay,
about the
so
book in
the book.
Okay, so
when the book comes, then you'll be able to see what it is. But I mean, it's not part of the motion, Councilor. That's what I'm saying.
It's in the motion that they're coming back in 2 weeks. You're asking me to vote to have them come back in 2 weeks and provide us with this information. I had a series of questions. I'm asking one more question that was not asked on the motion.
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to withdraw my motion at this time and let my counsel ask that question, then I'm going to put the motion forward again.
Second.
You're good.
Go ahead, Counselor. You have the floor now.
I've already asked the question.
Okay, let's get the answer then.
It's about 6.8 or 9 million, but it's in the book. I don't have it on top of my head, but it's almost $7 million.
Your operating expense is almost $7 million a year.
Plus the finance cost, plus all the costs of the plan.
Thank you, Mr.
It's all broken down in one of the DPU reports. There's all the financial information.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to make a motion. We're going to postpone this matter to the second FinCom in November based upon the stipulation that within 2 weeks we'll have a 20-page summary from the applicant Aquaria. We also will have the option to either get electronic or I myself want a hard copy, and you're going to coordinate that and send an email message back to them. And there will be a subcommittee group that Mr. Chairman will, a study group that Mr. Chairman will determine with legislative counsel.
Second.
And also Aquaria has made a representation that they'll hold off on the demand letter until such time. That's my motion.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. All in favor of that? Opposed? All in favor of that? And what we will do, I would ask each counselor before you leave this evening to please see our clerks here to indicate how you want it. I'll work with them so that they can report back to what we need, who wants electronic and who wants hard copy. I would ask that you please see one of the clerks tonight to tell them that before you leave so that we can stay on top of it. I'll stay on top of it with them because they work as our clerk. And then when all the information comes in, still has to come through to the clerk's office. Gentlemen, that's our city clerk, and it has to come into his office so it has a timely stamp to it so that it's been received to come into the council. Yes.
So just a clarification so I make sure that, you know, we come in here and do exactly what you guys want. We will get direction how many hard copies of each book you want. We'll get them. We will bring them to the city clerk.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
Within the 2 weeks.
Oh, yeah.
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 And
we'll
then the
it.
Summary will be within 2 weeks.
Yeah, we'll do it right away as soon as we get the message of how many you want.
You'll hear from either Anne Marie here or you'll hear from Karen from the auditor's office. They work as our clerk for this particular committee, and they're going to coordinate with me. I'll coordinate with them, and then you'll hear from them in a timely fashion within the next few days of what you need to do. Okay? Yeah.
Great.
Mr. Chairman.
Excuse me. Well, they can, but I'm not going to. Afterwards, just tell them now. That's what I said.
Do we need them to make copies?
Right, exactly.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor
Sullivan. In light of agenda item number 11, I would like to postpone agenda item number 8 until the second FinCom in November.
Second.
And
second.
Have them held tandemly.
Motion made and seconded to postpone item number 8 until the second FinCom meeting in November. All in favor? Opposed? So be it. And Councilors, just so you know, I have not set any finance date yet for November.
Thank you, guys.
Because of it being the Monday before election, I'm not sure. We may just move right to that third Monday, so it may be a big night, but just give us all a little break because we'll be in the campaign mode for the next couple of weeks. Councilors, City Council meeting will be Monday evening, October 26th, naturally here at 8 p.m. Any other?
Yes, Mr. Councilor Chairman.
Sullivan, Councilor.
I just want to take a moment of privilege. Oh.
Go ahead.
I just want to make sure that we wish our esteemed councillor from Ward 1 a happy belated birthday.
Yay! Happy birthday!
He celebrated a birthday late last week.
Thank you very much. What?
21.
59.
Councillor Sullivan.
A moment of personal privilege, if I may.
You may, Councillor.
I'd like to recognize two really great Ward 1 residents, and I know Councillor Cruz knows them as well. Carmen and Teresa Policino, they just celebrated their 75th wedding anniversary. Wow. They live on Pearl Street. He's a decorated World War II veteran, 75 years of marriage. So congratulations to the Policinos.
Councilors, before we leave, I'm going to ask Karen to do roll call, and she's going to ask whether you want electronic or you want hard copy so that we'll have this taken care of right now. Whichever one.
Okay. Shirley?
Hard copy.
Shana?
Electronic, please.
Tim Cruz?
Hard copy.
Dennis isn't here. Michelle Dua?
I'd like both.
Dennis?
Hard copy.
Tom Monahan?
Hard.
Moses?
Hard copy.
Hard. Jazz Stewart?
Electronic.
Paul Stravinsky?
Hard copy.
Robert Sullivan.
Could I have a hard copy of all three books, please?
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, moment of personal privilege.
Councilor Stravinsky, yes, you may.
There will be a meeting next Wednesday, the 28th of October, at the Davis School at 7 p.m. It will be an informational meeting on the proposed power plant in Brockton. There'll be some people there who will explain some of the do's, don'ts, what the fears are. Anybody is invited. Anybody and everybody. That'll be October 28th, 7 p.m., Davis School. All are welcome. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. And also, Councilors, I'll be hosting a Ward 3 meeting on Tuesday evening, next Tuesday, October 27th, at the Kennedy School. Any of my colleagues wish to come by, again, it'll be next Tuesday evening, October 27th, Ward 3 meeting at the Kennedy School. Please stop by. It'll be from 7 to 8:30 p.m. Any other business to come before this council?
Chairman, I just want to thank you for your leadership tonight.
Thank you. Appreciate it very much. Any other business to come before this council's committee? Seeing none?